Hi, good morning, everyone. I'm really delighted to be here today. And today I'm going to talk a little bit about transparency. So transparency is a term that we've heard a lot about, especially in the context of online privacy and online behavioral advertising. We hear about transparency, user empowerment, another good word, and choice. And so today I want to take a look at the transparency and user empowerment tools that have been developed and look at how well they actually work in practice, put them into the test. So I get a lot of targeted advertising, and sometimes I find it very amusing. This one seems to be targeted pretty well, or at least my kids say they definitely characterize me as an old woman with a computer science degree. And then there are other targeted ads that I think are really well targeted. You know, I've been shopping for cameras and camera accessories, and now I have lots of camera accessories that are following me around the internet, and that makes sense. And I wanted to drill down deeper and understand, you know, why these camera accessories exactly were following me around. So I clicked on that little blue triangle in the top right corner, and I got this nice explanation. And I actually click on that little triangle a lot because I'm really curious to see, since this is my area, you know, what is it that we're telling consumers when they click on that icon? And so this one has a bunch of useful information. So it explained that, first of all, these were the products that I had viewed on this camera website last time I was there. And people who viewed those products tended to purchase these other products. And if I didn't like having these camera accessories follow me around, I could temporarily disable these services or even permanently disable these services. So I thought that was fairly useful information. But from talking with other people and from some of the comments that I've seen in articles like this was from The Onion, there are a lot of people who don't understand this at all. And you know, the classic example is the shoes following me around the internet. And I can tell you I have shoes following me around too because I shop for shoes online. But a lot of people really don't understand why these shoes are following them around. They don't like it, and they don't know what they can do about it. And when I suggest to them that there actually are things they can do about it, they have no idea. Now, there's some other ads that are targeted for me that I really don't appreciate. So it's late at night, and I want to check the weather for the next day, and I keep getting ads for pharmaceuticals, in this case, antidepressants. And I don't really like that. So I click on the little icon, find out why. And I have this page here, but it's not nearly as useful as that other one that I showed you. And it tells me that these are ads likely to be of interest based on your web browsing activity. And I'm trying to figure out what it is that this advertiser knows about me that I don't. And I'm even more surprised when I get this ad. And I really wonder, why am I getting Viagra ads? And once again, it's ads likely to be of interest to you. And I'm trying to figure out why they think that this would be of interest to me. And so I keep reading. And it very nicely says that they'd like to provide me with clear information about how the ads are delivered and tools to control them. And so I keep reading, and it turns out there are actually 6 different companies involved in serving this ad. And it doesn't say which company served this particular ad, so I went and I read the policies for all 6 of these companies. I spent a long time reading that, but at the end, I still couldn't figure out why I kept receiving Viagra ads. And it wasn't just one. I got a whole bunch of them. So I found an email address. And I figured, okay, I'll email them and find out why I keep getting Viagra ads. So I sent a nice email and explained that I didn't understand what was possibly in my profile that was giving me these ads, and whatever it was, I'd like to remove it. And I got back an email that was very puzzling to me. It was from some third party I'd never heard of. And it seemed that a robot had probably read my email and assumed I was getting pop-ups on my laptop, and I wasn't. So this was, you know, kind of irrelevant to me. So not a particularly good experience. So then I decided to go learn some more about the Ad Choices icon and that program. So I went to that website, and I saw that I could take control of my ad choices. And I said, yes, that's what I'm trying to do here, so let's learn more. And then I went to the Digital Advertising Alliance page, which is where it takes you, and I read a lot there, and it said I could exercise some choice. It took me a while to figure out what I needed to do here. It turns out you have to click that button with the check mark on it. And then you get to this page and you wait a while it checks your status. And then eventually it comes up and it tells me that there are 129 companies and I've apparently already opted out of 97 of them. I don't quite understand what happened to the other 32, but okay. So that was my experience. Let's look at some research. Is my experience odd, or is this what is happening to other people? So at Carnegie Mellon University, which is where I am when I'm not at the FTC, I've been working with a group of students to look at this experience, and we've published a number of research studies, and I'm going to talk briefly about three of them, and these are all on our website if you'd like to go read them. So first we did a two-part lab study that involved involved 48 participants, and the first part was an interview study. And the second part was a study where people actually got to install and use some opt-out tools. So we interviewed people to find out about their attitudes about advertising and what they knew about online behavioral advertising and what they thought about it. Then we assigned each one a tool. We had 9 tools total, but each person only used one of them. And we asked them to learn about the tool and install it on their laptop, change the tool settings. Then we had them browse to some websites using the tool. And then finally, there was a follow-up interview. So what did we learn? Well, in general, the participants in our study characterized these online behavioral advertising using a number of different words. And we grabbed the phrase smart, useful, scary, creepy. So they did recognize the benefits that behavioral advertising has. They said for advertisers, it's a good thing. It can help them target the right person. And for consumers, it can also be a good thing because they can find the products that they're actually interested in. However, it raised a lot of privacy concerns. We also found that our participants really didn't understand how OBA works. And they had a lot of misconceptions about how it might work. And these misconceptions led them to have a lot of fears, some of which were probably not really justified, but you know, they would just assume the worst. They also had a lot of misconceptions about ad choices. We showed them examples of ads that had the ad choices icon, and we asked them, what do you think this means? What would happen if you clicked on this? And they said, oh, this is how you express interest in a product. Or maybe it's kind of like a your ads here sort of thing, if you wanted to purchase ads on this website. Or maybe that's how you go to the product's website. Or maybe that's how you see related ads. Very few actually understood what Ad Choices was really about. We also asked them how they thought they could prevent tracking. And most of them told us that they would just delete their cookies. Some of them said they thought there was something in their antivirus software suite that would help. A few mentioned web browser controls, and there are some who just said, no, it's not possible. You're going to be tracked whether you like it or not. It was interesting to hear how they talked about the different brands. In the Ad Choices program, you have an opportunity to look at those 193 or whatever different companies and decide which ones you want to block and which ones should track you. So we asked people how they would decide, and we asked them about a number of different companies and said, would you let this one track you? Would you let that one track you? And it was really interesting to see, this graph shows how willing people are to let different companies track them. And so in the bottom left, you see a bunch of companies that have names that may be very familiar to people in this room, but they're not familiar to consumers. And the consumer said, I've never heard of that company. Why would I let them track me? And then on the right side, these are companies that consumers have heard of. And it was interesting to hear how they made their decisions. So they said things like, oh, AOL, I know about AOL. Yeah, they had really crappy dial-up internet service. I don't think I'd let them track me. And then they'd say, oh, Microsoft, yeah, I have Microsoft software on my computer. I don't need another computer right now, so why would I want Microsoft advertising? And Google, oh yeah, I use their search engine all the time. They seem pretty cool. Okay, I guess they can track me. And so the decisions that people were making really had nothing to do with the tracking or the advertising. It was just what they knew about and how much they trusted the company in general. So we tested a bunch of different tools, and we tested this website was one of the things we tested. And as I mentioned, I had trouble figuring out where you would actually click here to opt out. I think every participant in our study had trouble finding that was where you actually click to opt out. Now, we did this study, it's been about 5 years, and I came back and looked at it this week, and it hasn't changed. It's still pretty much the way it was. We also found some participants, when it came up and said, you know, there are 32 companies you haven't opted out of, they tried to figure out how they would opt out of every last one of them. And what they found is that some of them were not actually English language websites, and they would go there and try to figure out how to opt out. And we had one participant actually typed, I think this was Japanese text, they copied it into Google Translate so that they could try to figure out how to opt out. I don't think most people would do that. We also tested some of the tools like Ghostery to see how well consumers could use them. And now this is Ghostery as of about 5 years ago in this picture. And people said that it was really difficult to configure. Do you want to enable web bug blocking, enable cookie protection? They weren't quite sure what those things are. Bugs, cookies, too many checkboxes. And then again, here's this list of all of these advertising companies I've never heard of, and I don't know how to make decisions about them. Now, this has actually changed. The latest version of Ghostery has a lot less jargon, but there still is this list of companies. Internet Explorer, we had people try to use their web browser to protect their privacy. And again, lots of jargon. Third-party cookies, compact privacy policy, first-party cookies, contact you without your implicit consent. These are all phrases that people looked at and they said, I don't know what this means. So in general, we found that users were unable to use these tools effectively. We recommended that the tool providers try to reduce the jargon and provide feedback so people knew what the tool was doing. And we have seen that a lot of these tools have improved somewhat since our study. We also think it's important to realize that most of these tools are based on the idea that you pick which trackers you want to block. And I don't think this is working. I don't think that consumers are really in a position to make judgments between trackers from all these companies they've never heard of. We also learned that because consumers, their instinct is just to delete cookies, the tools that rely on setting opt-out cookies are not really working very well. So then we did a follow-up study just on the ad choices icon. And here we had over 1,500 participants. And we recruited them online using Amazon Mechanical Turk, and they completed an online survey. So in this study, we showed everybody the front page of the New York Times, and we asked them to tell us about what sort of privacy features they saw there. Most people said they didn't see any. Some said, oh, if you scroll down, there's a link to a privacy policy. Almost nobody noticed that there are actually three ad choices icons that are on the screen. So then we showed them an ad with the icon, and we actually drew their attention to it. And we divided up our 1,500 people into a bunch of different groups, and they each saw a different tagline. So some people saw ad choices, but some people saw taglines like, why did I get this ad, or learn about your ad choices, or configure ad preferences, and some of them saw no tagline. We also did it so half of them saw the existing ad choices icon, and some of them saw this asterisk man icon, which was something that had been tested early on. So there's a lot of data. I'm just going to give you a couple of highlights. We asked people what they thought would happen if they clicked on the icon. More than half of them thought more ads would pop up. And about half thought it would take you to a page where you could buy advertisements on the website. Only 27% correctly said it will take you to a page where you can opt out of tailored ads. Now, when we tried some of the other taglines, we actually did get very different results. So for example, if you use configure ad preferences, which takes up a lot more screen real estate, but it does seem to communicate better. So there, we reduced the number of people who thought more ads would pop up. We reduced to 15%, which by comparison is almost nobody, think that it was a place to buy ads. And we got to 50% the people who had the correct answer. Now, can we do better? I hope so. How are we going to do better? Well, I think what we need to do is to try things and to do some actual testing. In general, I think most of the tools that are out there have not been well tested with consumers and could really benefit and improve with testing. Now, I've been focusing here on OBA and privacy tools, but there's a lot of other types of disclosures related to advertising that are out there. So disclosures that this is about native ads, that this thing that looks like content is actually advertising. So there has to be a little disclosure on there to tell consumers that. There are also other types of disclosures that are related to what's being advertised in the products. So all of these things are things that we could be communicating better about and would benefit from testing. So what criteria should we use to test and to measure effectiveness? Well, there's a lot of different things that we could look at, and depending on what our problem is, we have different criteria we might want to use. So to start at the beginning is the question of, do people notice the notice? So with that ad choices icon, I've talked to many people who swear they have never seen it. And it's always pretty funny when I talk to an audience and I say, how many people have seen this icon? And nobody raises their hands. And they all have computers in front of them. So I say, okay, go to your favorite newspaper website. Now look, do you see this icon? And they all go, oh, look, it's here now. Wow, I've never seen it before. Right, so noticing the notice is a first problem. Next, if it's a notice with text, do people actually stop and read the notice? If they read it, do they understand what they're reading? Or if it's an icon, do they understand what that icon means? Then does it actually contain information that they find useful? Is this what they actually want to know? And then finally, does it lead to a behavior change? Now, the leading to behavior change is actually somewhat tricky, because sometimes the behavior is actually to do nothing. And you know, if people read it and say, hey, I'm cool with that, then in fact they might not actually do anything. And so designing a user study that would allow you to test all these things can be tricky to do. But we think it's something that's worthwhile, and there are definitely organizations that have experience in doing this sort of testing. Finally, I'd like to announce today that the FTC is going to be doing a workshop to examine how to test disclosures. This was just announced like 20 minutes ago, so you're hearing it here first. It's hopefully on the FTC website right now. We'll be holding this workshop on September 15th in Washington, D.C. And we have a public call for participation. We're looking for people who want to tell us about their experiences testing disclosures. So that includes testing icons, testing long disclosures, testing innovative things. There are some companies that are experimenting with videos, with games, different ways of getting notices out there. We'd like to hear about your experiences, and we'd like you to come to the workshop and talk about it and to learn from others. So I hope that some of you will join us in DC on September 15th. Thank you.